Now, I've heard this name too many times, and I'm very delighted to be calling this person up to present the next session. So, of course, if your hands are not too busy, she is going to be engaging us on student engagement. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Pauline Tomlin.
Thank you. All right, good afternoon, everybody. Okay, you can do better than that. Come on now. That's more like it. I know you're tired. I know you're tired because if you're anything like me, you've been sitting here since 9 o'clock. And Dimeji, I want to have words with you because me been sitting here since 9 o'clock. Me tired, okay? Now, you might suss that I am not Nigerian. So when I start putting on my accent, please forgive me. It's in homage and in friendliness, not to mimic, okay? But it's a real honor to be here today. Dimeji, your colleagues, to Juliet and all the people involved in Edves, I think this is an amazing, amazing event, and I want to thank you all. So can we give them all a round of applause, please? Now, being an old lady, you, I am used to standing with a podium and my little, you know, my little file, because I like to do things the old-fashioned way. And this man here, Mr. AI, decides that I've got to, at the last minute, get my phone. So you know, sir, I've got glasses. Okay, my eyesight is not the best. So now you're going to have to bear with me whilst I try and read from my phone, all right? So if it's a little bit stilted, I apologize. But I'm hoping that there is at least one nugget of information that you can take away from what I'm going to tell you today, okay? So, without further ado, okay, I'm a little nervous. Now, one of the things that they say to do if you're presenting and you're nervous is to see the audience as naked. Okay, so I'm looking. No, I can't do it, oh. Sorry, I can't do it, okay? Don't worry, you look great with your clothes on. I'll leave it at that. All right. Now, the professor, I can't remember the gentleman who's just gone through the little door, they've got such credentials, and I feel to myself, wow, why am I standing up there? But what I do recognize, and what I want you all to recognize, is that you have a unique combination of talents and skills that you're bringing to your classroom. And the reason that I'm here is because of my unique combination of talents and skills. And there is value and there's worth in every single one of our experiences. So I'm hoping that I'll demonstrate that today. The overarching theme of Edves is explore, and that fits in very neatly with my topic of engagement. But what is engagement? Anyone tell me, what do we mean by engagement? Sorry? To evolve, yeah, potentially. To evolve, yeah. Any other suggestions? What do you mean by engagement? Okay, put your hands up if you're teachers. Teachers, okay? Well, it's the one word you should know how to define, or you should at least know what it means to you. Because without engagement in your classroom, there will be no learning. And the professor is very right when he says that stories are a very, very powerful way of engaging. And actually, he was like my intro, because a lot of my content talks about reclaiming story. Okay. My presentation is going to be split into three parts. The first one I'm going to ask you to do is to explore you. Okay? We often run into the job, we do what we have to do, and we forget that actually we're probably the most important thing or probably the most important person in that classroom. You know, do we examine who we're being when we're standing in front of those pupils? My second section will explore the history that the professor talked about, exploring history. And I'm going to give you a case study of how that leads to deeper and more profound engagement. And then the third section will ask you to explore the future, okay? Because one of the things I feel very passionate about is that we are here preparing our students and our young people for the world that they will inherit. And sometimes that can be a challenge for some of us because we come from a particular generation and a particular way of thinking. Okay? And so we have to expand who we are in order to prepare them for where they're going. Okay? There's also potential for education leaders, and I'll go through that as well. So no doubt you want to know a little bit about me, all right? I grew up in the north of England. I'm sure most of you can probably tell. So I'm not being, what do you call it? I'm not doing no shakara, okay? This is how I speak, okay? I grew up in the city of Leeds to Jamaican parents. So my connection to here is a long, tenuous one, okay? Actually, I think about 18% of me is Nigerian, according to my DNA, all right? But obviously, being from the Caribbean, I'm a bit of a mix, all right? I grew up, like I said, and what drives me is to contribute to the creation of an education system that will actually be thrilling, engaging, creative, and I want to see schools where if they have walls, my little granddaughter, who is 3, and she's bright, and she's bubbly, and she's beautiful, she actually wants to run in, okay? Too often, we see children who don't want to go to school. Like he says, it becomes tedious, all right? So a world full of beauty, a world full of questions, fearlessness, and confidence is what I am endeavoring to produce when I teach. I've had 2 careers before education. I was in marketing and media, and then I was recruiting for the marketing and media industry. And if you'd have told me that I would have ended up every single day in front of a room of other people's children, I would have run for the hills. I'd have said, no damn way. I'm sorry to use profanity there. Absolutely not, okay? But that's what fate led me to. And to be honest, when the signs came that that's the way my direction was going to be, I still resisted. However, the power up there knows far better than we do. And they knew that this is where I was supposed to be. This is my reason for being. And I can tell you I have loved every single stressful minute of it. Okay? It is a tough gig, isn't it, guys? Yeah? Come on. How tough is it being a teacher? All right, we do 5 shows a day, every single day, to the toughest audience on the planet. Yeah, you walk in, they go, miss, I don't like that nail varnish. Sir, what's that tie? Yeah, they are terrible. They don't care. They're non-discriminating and they will say what they think. But for me, that is the beauty of them. I learn from them every single day, and every single day I know I am going to laugh. And not many people have a job where they know every single day they're going to laugh. Someone is going to make them smile, okay? So we have to congratulate ourselves for being in one of the best professions on the planet. Okay, so really, really, really quickly, because I know I only have 30 minutes, just a few of my credentials, because you know you Nigerians like the numbers, okay? You like the titles, all right? I've been an educator for 14 years. I'm a mother to 3 very, very beautiful adult children, and like I said, a grandmother to 1 incredibly bright little granddaughter. I'll show you her picture later if you ask me. I rose rapidly from trainee to literacy coordinator, 2nd in department. I've led 3 departments to examination success. I've been an initial teacher training coordinator, as well as a qualified teacher status mentor. Notably in my career, the DFES, which is the overarching education body in the UK, gave my department a commendation for a 14% increase in our A star to C outcomes, and that was with a school that was designated in the bottom 2% for attainment in the UK. I came to Nigeria in 2016 to take up the position of head of English at the British International School in Vai. So I am, having listened to the statistics being borne out by, I'm sorry, I don't know your name, but I will find out later. It's quite shocking to me to listen to some of those, and I actually felt, you know what, I want to make it my mission to use what I've learned in order to help resolve that situation. But so I do admit that I am quite privileged in the sense that coming here, I taught in the private sector, okay? But trust me, y'all, In the UK, I have been in the state sector. And in the state sector, we don't exactly have quite the acute challenges that you have, but they are very different and nonetheless difficult. I have had children in my class whose mothers are junkies. And just that child getting to school in the morning and getting dressed is a miracle. I have taught children who come to school with police tags on their ankles because they were caught stealing cars the night before. So that's the kind of children that I've been used to teaching. I've had 6'4" boys square up to me because they want their mobile phones back, etc. So it's not easy. It's not easy, okay? And so hopefully those are my credentials. In terms of my time here, in the last couple of years, my first year, I got 92% A star to C passes in English in my faculty. And I took a very dejected department who had actually been bullied by their previous department head to that examination success. They were then, by then, a unified team. I love them to bits. I'm hoping to go see them again fairly soon. And then last year, we got 97% A star to C. The classes I've personally taught at IGCSE and A-level achieved 100% A-star to C-passes. My A-level class 2016 and 2017 got 100% A-star to C. And one pupil, now I didn't even know that Cambridge did this, but because it was my first year here. But one of my pupils achieved top in the world. Now, not top in Nigeria, top in the world across all the Cambridge centres, that is in the Southeast Asia, Canada, America, that is South America, that is, you know, Eastern Europe, etc. Top in the world. And she's now studying, I think, in Cardiff. Okay, right. In my opinion, we educators are the most powerful force for change within our communities and our society. What did I say we are? We are the most powerful change for our communities and our society. We see our children for more time than anybody else in their lives. We have the greatest influence over them that anyone else has. Okay? And most of you in this hall, because like the prof said, you're the dedicated ones, you are here, you made the effort. So you are the ones who care, you are the ones who wield a significant amount of influence, okay? What I'm hoping to do is give you some strategies to kind of look at what I actually do to engage and produce those results, all right? Now, my definition of engagement is that it's a sublime fusion of inspiration and motivation, which leads to creativity and wonder. Okay? Wonder, for me, means there is no bounds, no limits. It's about believing that any child, any one of those people in front of you, can do absolutely anything that they want to. And I think the minute that we lose that, that's where we lose the children. Okay? And we have to keep that alive in us. Now, to motivate, if we're talking about motivation and inspiration, to motivate, you need to be motivated, don't you? Yeah? Okay. Now, I think most of us can recognize that we know people in the profession who are, shall we say, perhaps a little less than dedicated. Okay? I think a young man in front of me here mentioned that there are many who go and end up in teaching because they wanted to do something else. Yeah, and that's one of the examples that I give you. So number one teacher who is perhaps less than dedicated, as an example, the teacher who leaves the staff room just after the bell. You know, the teacher who strolls to their lesson, ends up 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe 9 or even 10 minutes late to start the learning journey for their pupils. Then there's teacher number two. Teacher number two is the teacher who is frustrated and resentful. They're there for the paycheck because, quite frankly, this isn't what they originally wanted to do. And then the example I'm giving you of teacher number three is the teacher who, great at what they do, okay? But for them, teaching is an opportunity to dominate. Teaching is an opportunity to exert their authority, yeah? To be seen as, you know, puff themselves up and be seen as, you know, I have authority, I'm a teacher. Yeah? You must do as I say, okay? Now, for me, none of those examples, extreme as they are, can hope to motivate or inspire, okay? And I'm fairly certain none of you here are any of those, all right? So, what I'd like you to look at first is yourself. Who are you when you come into the classroom? What emotional literacy do you have when you're standing in front of those pupils, okay? Now, I'm going to click through my slides quite quickly because Dimeji here thinks I am an octopus. And Dimeji, I'm going to challenge you now to build me a little drone or something, robot or something that can do the clicking, read the phone, and do everything, hold the mic at the same time, okay? Because I'm sorry, I only have two hands and I can't do it. So hang on. Bear with me. Right. So that's what I define engagement as. That's my personal definition. Okay? But for you, it may be slightly different. Okay, so I'll just give you a minute to take that in. Now, no doubt, you're expecting me to give you, you know, some wonderful strategies that you can just transplant them into your classroom and voila, you have engagement. Maybe so, all right? I'm hoping that even if you can just take just one of those strategies, okay, maybe I can do this way, I can flip. All right, then it will help to invigorate and help you with the engagement in your classrooms. All right, so the three sections, exploring you, I'm gonna go through now. All right, so we'll go back to that one. All right, okay, so exploring you. All right, one of the things you need to look at when you're trying to get engagement is give them a sense of control. This is number one. Yeah? Somehow, I doubt teacher number three, the one who's into control and dominance, is going to give his students any sense of control whatsoever. But you've got to trust them. I've recognized, especially with my, what you would call perhaps the less academic ones, if you give them some control, within boundaries obviously, you plan the activity well, but you give them some choice within it, you'd be surprised at the outcomes that you can have. And that doesn't mean that there has to be chaos reigning in your classroom. That sense of control can be just a little thing, like, for example, in English, if I want them to respond to a question, I could just give them some choice. I can say, respond using a discursive essay, or respond through a poem, or respond through an autobiographical piece. The fact that you're giving them a little bit of a sense of control helps to inspire and motivate them further into the learning. Number two, please, 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 please define the objectives. How many children sit in classrooms every day and they have no idea what this learning journey is meant to be, where the hell they're supposed to be going, or how they're going to get there, okay? Make it clear to them where you expect, what you expect at the end of it, what they are likely to have learned, how they are likely to have improved by the time they adopt all the things that you're teaching them. And then they understand. If I said, go from here to Ibaron, I'll give you an idea of how to get there, won't I? I'll tell you, when you get to Ibaron, you'll see this first, and then you'll see this, and then you'll see that, and then you know you're there. Do you understand? Okay? But too often, we forget to give them the objectives. Number three, create a threat-free environment. Teacher number three is probably not very good at that, okay? Positive reinforcement is going to give you far more motivation, far more engagement, okay, than constantly telling them, no, that's not right, okay? I mean, who here, put your hands up, if someone constantly tells you, you're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong, I don't like what you're doing, who here would feel really great about themselves? Exactly, yeah? So positive reinforcement is really helpful, especially for those pupils who are perhaps not the most academically inclined, yeah? If you are praising them just for their effort, they will rise. In my experience, pupils rise to our expectations of them, have high expectations of them, okay? Number four, change your scenery. All right. I know some of us are restricted, and obviously listening to some of those conversations here, I know many of us are bound by some severe restrictions in terms of the physical space. Okay? If you've got a class of 75, you know, maybe what I'm saying is a bit of a nonsense to you. But if you have that option, then take the learning outside. Or maybe just take one lesson to the library. Yeah, or maybe just get them to do presentations themselves in a slightly different space. Just mixing it up will actually help enhance the engagement. Offer varied learning experiences. One of the things that there's some gentlemen in the room at the back, I think there's two sets of people here, are doing is they're using the interactive whiteboards. Dimeji and his group, they are really enhancing and using ICT where possible to add to the engagement opportunities in your classrooms. If you're able, take those opportunities, learn how to do them, because they are fast thinking. They are inheriting a very different world to the one that we are inheriting, and these technological initiatives will engage them far further. So even if it's just something like an interactive whiteboard, yeah, try and use them, because when you're using them, you're appealing to the different learning styles. We all know, don't we, that there are seven different learning styles. You have your visual, your auditory, your kinesthetic, the musical, naturalistic, the interpersonal learner, and the logical learner. And then you have multiple combinations of those. Me, personally, I'm much more visual and musical than I am logical. Okay? But if you're using these technologies, at some point in that learning journey, across your curriculum, across that term or that year, every learning style will have at least been touched on. So every child has the opportunity to learn in a way that suits how they learn. Okay? Number six is to use positive competition. Now, students, especially the boys, they like to pitch themselves against something, some kind of resistance or... And I'm not going to go into the psychology of boys versus girls. That's just one of the things that I think science has borne out and I've actually experienced in my teaching career. But the competition and the opportunity to test their skill is something that gets the blood going and gets them wanting to learn, wanting to find the outcomes, all right? So competition is another way of getting them to do it, and especially if you do it in group work. And when I say group work, it can just mean like pairs, you know, or groups of three. I like to use odd numbers when I do groups. Can anyone tell me why I like to use odd numbers when I do group work? Anyone have a guess? Sorry? Yeah, because when you use even numbers, you always get one who's like this. Yeah, and they're doing nothing. All the work's being done by the others. So the odd numbers usually means that there's at least three areas or tasks that have to be executed, and so they all have to take responsibility for something. Yeah, and then you can double those groups up and say, okay, now share your findings. So the two who were the organized, or the, you know, the one who's managing the team, you compare how you managed and what you learned from that. The two of you who were responsible for the content, compare notes. But if you do four, invariably somebody will be sitting back and letting the others do the work. That's in my experience. Obviously, the nature of your pupils might be different. So play around with it and see how it works for you. Please, guys, give praise where it's earned. Teacher number three, Mr. Authority, okay, who's there to feel superior, he's not giving any praise. Do you think there's going to be much engagement in his classroom? No. And please remember to not just praise the ones who get it right and get 100% every time. You've got to praise the ones who, for them, this is a mammoth effort, yeah? Every child is on a journey. Every journey starts with one step, but it doesn't mean that they're all going to get there at the same time. You take a snapshot of any classroom, and some may be in the foreground, some in the middle ground, and some in the background. But one thing I do know, and my 14 years of experience has taught me, is that they all get there in the end. Yeah, whether you're a hare or a tortoise, you will get there with your help, and that's where your expertise comes in. So please, praise the effort. Like I said, that child whose mother was a junkie, he lived with his grandmother who used to beat him. The fact that that child turned up to school was monumental. And so I would praise him for that. Okay? Because if I didn't, the next day I might not see him. Okay? So it's not just about the ones who get the A's and the A stars all the time. And I'm not saying leave them out, of course. But we've got to be psychologists and recognize the need for all of our pupils. Number 8, encourage self-reflection. And I would say that's for you as well. Reflect on your practice. What am I doing? Oh, okay, so-and-so was really bad in that class today. I'm not quite sure what's going on. How can I reflect on the strategies I use? Is there something else I can try tomorrow? And this leads me into the next one, get to know your pupils. Because that pupil who was challenging that day perhaps has got something going on. Now, if you just say to them, are you all right, so-and-so? You don't quite seem yourself today. You know what? If you need to, just come and have a chat. Don't make them. But the very fact that you recognized that for them may mean that they may welcome and talk to you. And you will get a deeper understanding of how then to offer the learning for them as they move through. It may be a temporary situation. It may be that you need to then bring together a team of people within the school to give that child further support. But if you're ignoring them and just shouting at them, so-and-so, you're not usually like this. Why? What's wrong with you today? I'm sorry, but you're going to lose that child. Yeah? And then you're adding to the issues that are perhaps being compounded and hindering them from learning in that moment. All right? So that's be interested in them. And number 10, make it fun. Yeah? Wherever possible, make it fun. Now, these are strategies that when Dimeji first asked me to do this, I was like, God, what do? I know I must be engaging because I get good results. But I really had to sit and think, what is it that I do that does this? And these, I think, are my top 10. But I think if I was to add an 11th, I would say it's bring yourself and your life experience into the classroom. Because one of the things I'm very good at doing is talking to them about why they should do something or the outcome of something. You know, I've used my brother's death as an example of why you should not decide to become a drug dealer. Okay? When they know you know what you're talking about and you have experience, it increases the respect that you have from them. And all children will work harder and work well for a teacher that they respect. But they won't do it because you tell them to or because you are their teacher and you are the authority. Yeah? They're very good at paying lip service and then they'll run out and do nothing. Okay, as a result of it. So if you really want engagement, you really want a classroom that you can enjoy as an educator, then try and employ some of these strategies. So I'm going to put the list of them up on the board and give you a minute or two to digest. I will, if people want to give me their, if people go on my website and put their email addresses in and put Edves on my contact form, I will send you a PDF version of this, so you don't have to take lots of notes, because I'm aware of time, and I'm aware that I have to skip through, okay? So let me get to that slide. Those are your 7 learning styles. I know it's not very bright there. So you have your musical, your logical, your verbal, your interpersonal. Some children are much more about relationships. Others are very logical thinkers. Maybe your mathematicians. But it doesn't mean that they're not good at English either. Okay, and again, please don't make any assumptions about what you think about your students. Always be open to what they're capable of doing, okay? And the other thing I've noticed is that please don't compare them to their siblings. Please, please, please don't do that. My sister, unfortunately, came after, I'm the eldest of 3. She was always compared to me because I was a bit of a bookworm. I was a swot. I just liked learning. It wasn't a happy time for her. And she spent a lifetime getting over the psychological damage of she's not the clever one. Okay? She's completely different to me. And actually, she is. She has a master's degree now and I don't. So it was a nonsense, do you know what I mean? So please don't compare them to their, because they're individuals and they have individual talents and skills. So these were the ones, the 6 and the 4 are the 10, my top 10. Okay, so like I said, I will give you the opportunity to sign up and you can get a copy. Now, I'd like to go into section 2 now. Section 2 is about allowing... I think the professor would like this one, okay? Because my section 2 is very similar to what he was talking about. And that is, stories. Stories and history and narratives, okay? And I'm going to tell you a story of my schooling, okay, as quickly as I can. Being brought up in the north of England as the child of black immigrant West Indian parents meant, and I was quite clever, because, you know, I was always getting into trouble for asking why. You know too much, is what them tell me. You know, shut up, you know too much. Now, what I realize now is that those the questions I was asking, the adults in my life couldn't answer, which is why they shut me up. But it led me to kind of keeping myself a little bit small in some way, yeah? Because you're always being told, shut up, you know too much. It was always confused me. How can you know too much? I mean, you know, there's so much to know, isn't there? Do you measure? You're always exploring, aren't you? You're always looking for new ways, new opportunities. And that's the kind of child I was. This is what we should be opening up for our children. Don't ever tell them that they know too much or they shut up or you're always asking why, okay? It's very, very damaging for a child. But my school was devoid of any positive imagery, really, of people that looked like me. Yeah? In every single class I sat in, you see me one that looked like this, yeah? With me fine cocoa skin and me twist up head, I was the only one. Every single class, all the way through 20 years of schooling, from the age of 4 to the age of 24 when I graduated. Yes, I went, I was a bit of a slow learner towards the end. I graduated at 24. Not one teacher looked like you guys. None of my experience or my stories were ever seen as positive or related to me. In fact, the only time I remember being visible, can you guess which subject it was? Which subject would I have been visible? Sorry? Athletics, no, I was sporty. I was in practically every team going, but no. Which subject was I visible where somebody suddenly looked around and went, oh!
Black history.
Black history, are you kidding me? I would have loved to have had black history in my school. Now remember, I'm brought up in 1970s Britain, there's a lot of racism, okay? No, history, not black history, history. And which section of English history would they have been looking at me going, oh, Pauline, what do you know about that then? Which section? Begins with an S. Slavery, yeah. You know, because I'm the oracle for slavery. You know, because I know everything about slavery and I know all about my own race. Me one, sitting there, 12. Excuse me, okay? So that was my experience. And in a certain way, it makes you shrink subconsciously because you don't feel like there's any value in who you are, what your experience is. Whitewashing leads to distortion. And our curricula, now, for me, my experience, so you've got to excuse me, is UK and then private schools here. So excuse me if your experience is very, very different, but there is still very much a Western emphasis in a lot of the curricula, okay? Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie said in her TED talk, The Danger of a Single Story, that it wasn't until she read Things Fall Apart, and she'd been writing stories since she was about 5 or 6 and giving them to her mum, but all her characters had blonde hair and blue eyes, and they drank lashings of ginger beer, because those were the stories that she was reading from Enid Blyton and all those English writers. Don't get me wrong, their literature is great. But they weren't writing about anyone that looked like us or any of our experiences. And so we feel as though our experience has no value. It takes seeing others as ourselves to motivate and inspire and get that engagement. So what I'm going to challenge you to do is just to listen to a little case study that I did. And it kind of grew organically. I actually came here thinking that the experience on the continent, would be far better. That the children here would know all about their history, or do you know what I mean? They'd know their value, they'd know their worth, they know their names. Some of them actually didn't even know the meaning of their names. And I was heartbroken, because one of the things I had desperately wanted as I grew up was to know what my name would have been. Because remember, my name is not my name. My name is a slave owner's name. So when you have a name that is based on this continent and then you tell me you don't even know what it means. So one of my assignments was go home and find out the meaning of your name. And I made every single one of them tell me. Now you can you imagine the pride and the kind of puffing out of their chest that happened when every single one of them sat there and told me, oh, my name means God's blessing. I mean, what a beautiful name to have. My name doesn't mean Jack. Tomlin is probably some Scottish slave owner's surname. Do you know what I mean? I'm saddled with somebody else's identity. Now, I've accepted that, that's fine. But use that to bring pride into your children, okay? Tell them to not call themselves, oh, my name's Tom. No, your name is Chidi, okay? Chigozie, and be proud of it, okay? Now, when I found out that these children did not know their own history, they were even less knowledgeable than me, because as an adult, I'd spent a lot of years reclaiming. I knew that the image of my people was not, it couldn't be a right one. The image that I only dropped into the earth steaming as some kind of slave could not be right. Because I saw people in my community with dignity and pride, clean like you would not believe, scrupulous, funny, humorous, all those kind of dimensions of human endeavor were in my community, my family, my aunts, my uncles, my cousins. I just thought, this can't be right. So as an adult, I studied black history, and trust me, it's hard. Finding black history in the UK is really hard because it's buried. They don't want you to reclaim who you are. Because when you claim who you are, you stand tall, you puff out your chest, innit? Yeah? And you go, damn, Wakanda. Yeah? I'm from Wakanda. Come on now. Do you know what I mean? And you feel proud of yourself. So reclaiming that, I then started to share that with them. And when I spoke about the Benin Bronzes, Ife, etc., they started to go, huh? I was like, okay, I was aghast. So I thought, I've got a job to do here. We started with a co-curricular group. That group led to investigation, stimulated conversation, and I'm telling you, the engagement that created spilled over into their main curricular lessons, okay? The triumphs of their ancestors enthralled them, okay? And they realized that they'd been historically shortchanged. They began to connect the dots as to who they could possibly be and gave them an even stronger root system on which to hold themselves strong and firm. For once, as Chimamanda said, they could see themselves in the picture, okay? Now, we ended up publishing a book. I'll show you it here. I have a copy of it here. This is just, we ended up publishing this because they were so imbued with enthusiasm for the new knowledge and feelings that they'd found. And this book was a great opportunity because not only did it give them some pride, etc., but it actually became a revenue stream for the school. Okay, so I've decided to put that together as a project, 8, 10 or 12 week project that I'll take into schools to get them to investigate and explore who you are and so that writing can come out which is authentic. Okay, now it coincided with the Queen's Commonwealth competition. The writing that they produced, they sent in. And that year we had more commendations, more silver and gold certificates than any other year of entering that competition because the writing was sublime. One child wrote about a child soldier and his loss of education. Another wrote about a woman continuing the cycle of polygamy and explored her thoughts and feelings around it. Because these were things that they'd heard about. These were concerns about their lives. These were issues that they thought about. These were the things they saw in their news reports. I'd like to read two extracts, if I may, because even as I read them years later, I just think the power of the writing from these children is just amazing. So if you'll bear with me, I'd like to read them for you, all right? Just two extracts. This first one is the end of the tale about the boy soldier, okay? The chomping of the boots is further at first before coming closer, till it resembles the sound the women in his village make when pounding yam. The first person he sees is Helene. His clothes are tattered and torn, and his face is bloody, and the soles of his boots are worn through. There is a piece of cloth that seemed to be functioning as a bandage wrapped around his torso, but he's smiling. All of them are, and that confuses and disorientates Aziz. It had disorientated him when they were smiling when they came, and they continued to smile whilst recounting all that had happened on their expedition. Whilst talking about setting fire to a church, whilst talking about bombing markets and schools, their smiles even widening whilst talking about cutting open a pregnant woman. It is in that moment that Abdulaziz realizes that something must be wrong, and he can't quite put his finger on it. Then he is sad because he realizes that he may never know, because he can't think, can't dream, can't imagine. Looking back, Abdulaziz would have been chosen differently. He looks around and sees people laughing about murdering a woman and her unborn child. He thinks of the merciful and benevolent Allah he's heard of and thinks surely Allah wouldn't approve of this. But he doesn't know, and the answers to his questions are trapped in the pages of the Quran, something he may never be able to unlock. His mind pictures all the bloodshed he's just been told of, and he shudders. He wishes he could stop it. At that moment, he begins to regret so much because he realizes where so many of the solutions lie. In all those books with covers of children in uniforms that he'd never thought he needed. But on the cool evening in the forest, 1,000 miles from the closest town, he begins to accept that he does. Okay, and then the... Sorry, you can clap. It's honestly, I think it's wonderful writing. You can clap. Right, okay. And then this... Okay, this next one was a pupil who wanted to write about the abduction of the Chibok girls. Okay, because it was something that she felt really upset about. She didn't... Do you know what I mean? So she wrote about that. So this is the beginning of that piece. It's called Our Stolen Peace. She stares, perplexed at the topic that is printed in its size 9.5 Calibri font. It is not written boldly, but yet it hits her. Peace. If you're looking for a story that will explain the meaning of peace or the meditation techniques, I will tell you firsthand that this is not that story. This is a story written purely based on the simple observations which were made by a 14-year-old African girl, considering the endless quick fixes society has prescribed for her once glorious father's land that have yet failed again. If you will permit me, I will take you back in time to the year 2014. This was the year when the terrorists finally decided it was time for the world to play hide and seek with over 200 girls in a forest called Sambisa. It was a time when the terrorists thought they had stolen the girls, and to tell the truth, this is the part we mainly acknowledged. But the part that was important, but is never given as much publicity, is the part that involved our peace. Yes, the peace of hundreds of mothers was stolen that day. Little did they know, the moment their daughter faded into the horizon, it would be the last time they would watch her wave from afar. Little did they know that the exam that the girls were going to sit, that was supposed to give them a future beyond the small village of Chibok, was the day the terrorists decided to steal their peace. Now, that was the start of another story. Now, in terms of the writing, can anyone tell me how old these children were when they wrote these pieces? What do you think in terms of the language and the kind of content? Sorry? Year 7. Oh, that would be great, actually. No. Year 7. Sorry? 14. They were 13. Yeah? 13 years old. And this is the poignant, sophisticated writing that came out of us reclaiming history and the stories of their history and them deciding, I have value. My stories and the things that are important to me should and can be written about. And the engagement that that created swelled over and passed across the curriculum because they were now interested in themselves and felt pride in who they were. So that's number two. And number three, section number three, is really quick. We've run out of time. Okay, we've run out of time. So section number three was just really, really quickly that there is a future that we need to be preparing our children for. Everyone's talking about the fourth industrial revolution. The skills that are required, critical thinking, yeah? Creativity. And yet these things are often disappearing from our curricula. What I'm saying is, in order to engage, you'll get more engagement if you show these young people that you're interested in the world they will inherit. We can't keep them straddled and strapped to the industrial age that we were trained for. They're being trained for the future. That's what we should be doing. So embracing technology like the AI of the Edves Catalyst people, embracing critical thinking, entrepreneurship. Can you imagine school owners if all your 16 and 18 year olds came up with a business plan that was actually solving a problem in their community, in their wider culture, okay? And you have an opportunity for investment to support them. Imagine how your country would grow. Listen, Africa is on the rise. And not before time. You people in this hall have the greatest potential to be a part of that rise. You are the ones who will influence the leaders. You are the ones who will influence the entrepreneurs, the inventors, and the managers of the future. Use it wisely. Employ some of these techniques. Motivate and inspire. I have been Pauline Tomlin. Thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you very much. Okay.